Hi, and welcome to my talk, What Do Large Changes Tell Us? A taxonomical study of large commits. This work was done in 2008 and published when MSR was still a workshop. The conclusion of our study is that although large changes might look like outliers in the large datasets extracted from source control system, we've shown that these commits are often fundamental to a project structure, and many of the larger commits are actually relevant to the entire architecture of a project, whether by importing something or large-scale changes. So, the context at the time was I, Abram Hindle, was in Waterloo. I was doing my PhD. I'd just come from UVic, where I did my master's with Daniel German. And at Waterloo, Rick Holt and Mike Godfrey were my supervisors. On this paper, it was just me, Daniel, and Rick. In terms of effort and order, it was in that order as well. Michael decided to opt out of the paper. He was program chair at the time, so he thought that would complicate things. So he explicitly stayed out, which I have an email of. But he wasn't the program chair of ICPC2, so we submitted an extension to this where we applied machine learning to classify large changes, and Mike was on that paper. So in general, the way that I've worked in my research career is that I have a set of interests that help motivate things, and these interests typically feed into my research. So the interests that I typically had at the time were music information retrieval and drawing to make music and making music with different user interfaces, especially video and connects. Also a lot of signal analysis. And in terms of software, I really cared about programming, and I cared a lot about functional programming and dynamically typed languages. So I did a lot of Common Lisp, I did a lot of Ruby, did a ton of Perl, and did some Python at the time. And I was really into Haskell and OCaml and stuff like that. And I like Scheme a lot. So I was always interested in how to build software and how to build software well, but I was also interested in music and making music software and making making interfaces that interacted with me or motion or things like that. So I didn't learn any machine learn. All the machine learning that I learned typically was in music information retrieval and music, and a lot of the stats and machine learning that I was motivated to learn by music I would apply later to software engineering, whether it's signal analysis or metrics or PCA applied to something. My research at the time was more like visualization and software metrics on indentation and mining software repository stuff, and later some signal analysis applied to software engineering signals. I collaborated with a bunch of people, ranging from supervisors like Daniel German, Mike Godfrey, Rick Holt, Prem Dembu, and Zhendong Su. Collaborated with very people's students, such as Chris Bird and Tom Zimmerman and Daryl Posnett and Jack Shemin. And later at U of A, I collaborated with my U of A colleagues like Eleni and Nelson, as well as Rick Holt lineage students such as Ahmed Hassan and his students, Emad and Jack. So interacted with a whole bunch of students, different labs. Really couldn't be here without this kind of collaboration. It really bolsters a research career, and people help you stay on the right track, and they ask the right questions that you probably overlooked. Now, in terms of this paper, who came before for this paper? Well, we'll start with Maurice Halstead. He came up with a book on software science itself, which I found somewhat influential, and I really enjoy a couple of his metrics, like Halstead volume, in terms of source code readability. It's quite useful there. Next up is Manny Lehman. In my master's, I was very inspired by Manny Lehman because he came out with Lehman's Laws of Software Evolution. So he came out with pretty easy to code up and easy to formalize laws of how software changes over time. And you could prove or disprove them or apply it per project. And that was really interesting. And so my master's was on was on a version control, source control language that you could ask first order logic and temporal logic queries of. It wasn't super useful, and the intent was basically to look for Lehman's laws using first order logic and temporal logic. We got Swanson in the middle there, and he came up with a classification of maintenance types, different types of software maintenance. And then the other authors here were either supervisors or they had produced papers that investigated commits. So first off, the big prior work that we use in this paper is Swanson's maintenance classification. He came up with adaptive, perfective, and corrective classifications of software maintenance. And this is one of the earlier studies, earlier investigations into software maintenance. In 2006, a promise Amor, Robles, and Gonzalez investigated commits and used and tried to discriminate between commits using models. Parashutaman and Perry, they investigated via coding what small changes were. They discussed what they were because they were very prevalent. What's a typical commit? A characterization open source repository is by Al-Ali, CAGD, and Maletic. That was at ICPC the same year. So there was a bunch of work that worked on commits, but none of them specifically looked at large commits on their own in depth. So how do we get onto the large commits thing? Why do we bother to look at large changes? Why do we think they're important? Well, it started off with Daniel sending me an email in November of 2007. Daniel said basically that we should go look at big changes. We should go look at blips in the data. These blips are probably big copy and paste between projects, so they're importing a bunch of code, and it's probably some kind of form of legal plagiarism, basically code sharing and open source. And so we were meant to go and look at these blips, but Daniel misspelled it and he wrote blimps. So blimps in the data still makes sense because you're looking for big things, right? And blimps are typically not that small. So I probably ignored his email for a month, and then I responded with a Git repo that I invited him to. I said, "Hi Daniel, I'm sorry for being so flaky," and I came up with the title, "What are large changes?" And then my abstract was, we expect that large changes can be characterized in a few groups. Some of these groups are library inclusion, license changes, large gifted patches, massive cross-cutting concerns, renamings, loggings. So we're expecting to find those things. Daniel and I collaborate quite well using version control in my master's, and we continue to still collaborate in my PhD using roughly the same system where we'd discuss over email, but we typically commit ourselves via CVS, SVN, Darks, or Git. And we use all of those. And eventually, once we went to Darks, it was pretty nice, but Darks had some severe bugs with, I think, MP merge resolution. So everyone kind of switched off of Darks to Git at the time. In terms of the commits, the day of the paper was due accounted for about half of the commits for the paper, which also includes coding as well as tagging. So why do we look at the large changes? Well, the community said at meetings that large changes could be ignored. They said that large changes were oftentimes irrelevant to what you wanted to do, so you should filter them out. It was considered good statistical practice to remove outliers. It's just, you know, kind of bogus data that didn't really matter. So a lot of people argued that these large changes were outliers because they simply rank-wise really didn't fit. So people were like, they're outliers. You can ignore them. If you use them, they wreck your models. Some people said, they're ignorable because they're noise. You just don't need them. They're not the actual signal of software development. So just ignore them. And even if they are software development, typically they're non-functional changes. So an example of a non-functional change would be like a license change. So they'd be changing the license to like BSD or GPL or Mozilla or MIT or whatever. So you had these different licenses that they could be changed to. And because it was open source and because it had licenses, it was fundamentally about copyright. And typically, a big commit you'd see yearly is the copyright year would get updated across all headers. So you'd have a big commit that changed all files and didn't change their operation, simply changed the copyright. Or you have an author and you add that person to the files. So in order to challenge that view of what large changes were and that large changes were non-functional, we had to get our hands dirty and get deep down in the data and kind of inspect what was going on. We didn't have a data set that was gifted to us. We didn't have like a really nice extracted data set. So we had to go and do it ourselves. It's a little bit different than nowadays where oftentimes extraction steps are unnecessary because other researchers such as Georgios have already done it for us. In fact, at the moment, a lot of analysis you can just do in a spreadsheet with a simple query from ghTorrent. You know, you can plot the whole thing. I've got a paper here at ICSI where we were using Boa and we didn't have to really touch a lot of the projects themselves. At the time, a lot of MSR was bean counting in the sense of characterizing distributions. That was very popular. And not a ton of investigation. Like, in terms of commits, those prior works that I already cited, they were pretty well it. So wasn't a ton of investigation. And so by closely looking at the data, we're doing something that wasn't done a lot at the time. Essentially, this is, you know, kind of pre-grounded theory, pre-qualitative kind of research that the community eventually moved off into. So we used a kind of archaic coding style that didn't use inter-rater reliability, and whenever we observed something, we'd tag it. The way we tag it is there'd be commits listed in a CSV file, and as we inspected the commit, we'd use macros in Vim. So I was using Vim at the time, so I'd press like two keys, like QA, QC, QL, or whatever, and then it would label that commit that was currently on in the CSV file with the annotation. And Daniel was always in the Emacs, so Daniel had Emacs macros to do something very similar. So we had both implemented our own little tagging systems. But what we really found was like these macro systems are actually really nice for data management. Later on, I was doing coding stuff, and I was just using S expressions and Emacs par edit, and I was just adding annotations that way, and that actually worked really great. So sometimes you don't need fancy pants software, sometimes you just need something that's got nice macros. So me and Daniel worked that way, and our commits, our tags, would be added to the Git repository, and then it would be analyzed by our scripts. The tags that we used ranged from branching, to cleanup, to assets, to documentation, to module moves or removes, to renamings, and then these were pretty fine-grained. So what we do is we then associate them with one of the Swanson categories, such as corrective, adaptive, or perfective. What we found is that a lot of changes were implementation. They had really little to do with maintenance. So we added a category for implementation. And then for changes that wouldn't change the functionality, like changing the license and that, we put those into a new category of non-functional changes, like non-functional requirements. When we analyzed it, some projects were more biased towards certain kinds of changes than others. For instance, the Samba project, which is in an orange at the bottom, it was very big on adaptive changes. And this is because it had to adapt to the Microsoft ecosystem, whereas PostgreSQL was more concerned about performance, so a lot of its changes were perfective. Some projects, like Firebird or Boost, were relatively even across their projects. In total, what we found is the proportion of changing belonging to each category showed that only about 20% of the changes were non-functional. So the community view that these changes were mostly license changes or outliers or something like that was a little bit off in the sense that 80% of these changes actually changed code. And these are big changes. And these big changes are changing code. Well, that basically means that they're architecturally relevant. So you have to watch out. So we concluded that in these large data sets, they weren't exactly outliers, that many of them were relevant to the actual software architecture itself. And if you cared about the software architecture of the system, ignoring large changes was done so at your own peril. Other authors such as Ambrose and Lanza and Hattori and Lanza and Herzig and Zeller and Lowe and Emad and Shahib and Hassan and Dragon and Miletic and Kagdi and Miletic, all these authors followed up and directly cited my work and used my work to motivate their work or talked about my work in terms of large changes and said what large changes were, or they covered all the bases of commits and did tagging and then corroborated with what my paper had said. So these are just a small sampling of true follow-up works that aren't like train sites or anything like that. There was a lot of other citations, which is why I got the MIP award. And obviously, like, I couldn't have done it without you all actually citing the work, which I thank you greatly for. But nonetheless, these ones were clearly the direct descendants of the paper. Now, why did this paper matter? I think it mattered because there was an obvious community perception, and via measurement, we could take that and we could show that they're wrong or inaccurate. People would say, oh, but it's obvious, you know, like, you just look at it, it's obvious. Well, you know what? Until we actually publish an empirical study about it, it's obvious is not good enough, because then everyone else has to do the work again. Because everyone else has to do the work again, then they don't do the work, or they avoid it, or they try to skip it. But actually, by doing it, A, it surprises the community, and they realize one of their assumptions is probably incorrect. And two, it allows the community to suggest large changes are blank, and they just cite the large changes paper, which is great. But the big issue was that the reviewers didn't know, I didn't know, no one really knew what was there. And this goes and shows that, you know, you got to be careful. There's some real code changes. So the real concern is, but what if what we don't know isn't immediately actionable? I don't know if this paper would do so well today if, like, there wasn't prior work of it. I think there would be issues about motivation and how is this useful to developers? Is this actually useful to researchers? So there's this really big kind of divide in terms of research relevance versus stakeholder relevance. All right. So the reason why I'm bringing up relevance and would we be able to publish and do we know or don't we know is that in other fields of science, it took a big buildup of many different little things in order to get something useful at the end. So one field that's interesting was photography. In photography, you had some economic motivations, like people want pictures of themselves, and getting some of the paint pictures was expensive. You have different motivations in terms of that. You've got the need for different technologies in order to take pictures of things in space versus things that are fixed. You need lenses or something along those lines in order to actually focus light in order to take good pictures. So there's a lot of technology that had to come together. One example is the silhouette. The silhouette got motivated because portraits were expensive, so there was an economic motivation for it. Silhouettes were an example of using projection of light in order to cast a shadow and then usually manually cut out a silhouette or paint a silhouette onto a surface. There was some attempt to make permanent silhouettes with silver nitrate and silver chloride in order to fix shadows, but a lot of silhouettes were just done manually. And they could do it because you can project a hard shadow pretty easy without a lot of work and without lenses. And so it was pretty easy to project a shadow onto something that you could work on and cut out. So projection was important, as well as eventual chemical processes to make silhouettes automatic. Another neat invention was the camera obscura. There was an observation that if you have a small little portal in a dark box, that light would come through and it would shine against the other wall. The image would be inverted, but it would still be there. And the camera obscura was made long time ago. Like, there's records of camera obscura in 1100 AD. So this was known for a very long time. So the idea of the camera existed. Now you might think, well, what's the point of seeing something in the dark? Well, A, you could secretly spy on people, so that was cool. Or you could put a piece of paper there on the other side, it projected on, and then you could trace on that paper based on the projection. So you could make something very realistic. In about 1825, the piece came out with a bitumen-based process where he took an engraving and he shone light through the printing of the engraving, and the light went through the light spots and hit the bitumen, and that would change the color of the bitumen on the plate. So after about a week, you would get basically a copy of an image that you've already made. Now, it seems kind of silly because it's an engraving, which means that you could just ink it up again and do it again. But this projection of light onto a chemical surface to cause color change basically revolutionized everything. A, it was automatic. It wasn't like the silhouette. B, it showed that if you could focus the light, you could do it. It wasn't until the next year where Nepis took a real photo. Now on a bitumen-covered plate, he basically exposed the photo for over a week. Some historians say it was a day, but generally the agreement is about a week of exposure, and this is basically the first earliest surviving photo. And there's an enhanced version behind it. You can see it's some kind of towers and buildings somewhere in France. It's pretty neat. But you're not going to take a portrait of someone if it's going to take a whole week to expose. But the important part here is that you wouldn't get to photography unless you had a bunch of things that weren't immediately actionable that you could build up upon later. You needed the camera obscura, and that existed for hundreds of years. You needed motivation as well as the skills or understanding of silhouette and projection. You also needed the idea of photosensitive chemicals, which, you know, came later in like the 1820s. There was some other photosensitive chemical uses at the time, but they were usually temporary, and most people wanted to use the chemicals for tests rather than for imaging. It wasn't until later, in the 30s, with daguerreotype, that they eventually used silver compounds that acted a lot faster than bitumen. But it wasn't until like 1880 where you could take a photo in less than 30 seconds. So I bring it up because it took many little things to get there, and not every one of them was actionable. Not everyone was immediately useful, and not everyone was feasible or practical. So a while back, when I was in Kingston for my sabbatical, I visited, I had lunch with Jim Cordy at his favorite schnitzel place, Amadeus. We had schnitzel, it was good, and we talked about papers. And one issue that came up was papers getting rejected because they lacked motivation, or the reviewers didn't buy the motivation, yet the paper was still technically correct. So this was a bit of a concern because, you know, sometimes it's not always obvious how useful something is. If we go and look at the field of biology, the usefulness of measuring the speed of a bat crawling isn't necessarily obvious, but it could be used later, it could be used in kind of a general locomotion study or some kind of theory-building exercise. The same is with software. So we've got this issue where our community is called software engineering, and if we go and look at engineering, engineering is about solving problems with constraints, solving problems with economic constraints. And that's different than science. And supposedly many of us are in a computer science kind of deal. Science doesn't necessarily need that kind of economic constraint or motivation. A lot of it can be observation. And the economic problem solving doesn't necessarily happen when you're making an observation. So we basically discussed that there maybe needs to be an understanding of software science by the community, such that software science papers could be reviewed by either a software science venue or be reviewed in such a way that's relevant to software science rather than relevant to software engineering. Now, software science isn't a new idea. Maurice Halstead's got elements of software science, and there's departments of software science. So we weren't really coming up with anything new, but we were identifying an issue in the community where a lot of software science gets rejected because the motivation isn't bought. And now, this can also be a generational thing. If young people write something about social media, software development, I might be very skeptical of it. Whereas if I write something about mobile software development and energy in mobile, I think it's relevant, but some people in generations prior to mine don't really think it's necessarily all that relevant. So there's issues of taste, understanding, motivation, and the motivation thing seems like a bad idea in terms of a reason to can a paper. So back to engineering and science, I think the engineering that we do and the way we review for engineering is, can I use it right now? Can I deploy it to a practitioner? But in a lot of cases, we still have the scientific inquiry. And, you know, MSR has got a lot of empirical papers, and we saw that many of them were accepted. They had a pretty good acceptance rate. But the science papers always face this kind of criticism. Who's going to use it? How do you use it? I don't know if you should really always have that kind of answer. The engineering papers are supposed to be relevant now, and we accept that. They should be relevant to stakeholders like developers and managers immediately. And they should actually solve a problem, because if you're not solving a problem, you're not doing engineering. If you're studying something and you're recording it and measuring it and you're not really sure about the application, it's definitely more of a scientific endeavor. It might lead to something that'll help a developer or a stakeholder, but maybe not. Furthermore, it probably takes multiple rounds and iterations of to solidify knowledge through empirical studies such that we can use it later. Once the knowledge is solidified, it can be integrated into tools and eventually deployed to an end software developer. But the big issue is, if we reject the not immediately actionable, we basically hobble our future. We really limit what our field can do, and we basically don't allow for things that, like Andy was suggesting, like theory building, if we don't have, you know, clear reasons for the theory, or the theory is not immediately useful. So it's a bit of a problem. So we really got to consider the fact that, you know, sometimes papers have to study the obvious, because unless the obvious is studied and citable, then we keep having to test the obvious, or the community accepts maybe an incorrect premise about the obvious. Because, you know, common sense isn't necessarily shared across people because we have a different definition of common sense. So that was my soapbox. What I was getting at is, we got to get close and dirty to the data sometimes. And the good MSR papers, in my opinion, they do their bean counting, and then they go in and they try to explain why via close inspection. I think those are important. If you want a pattern for a paper to publish, you can ask the question, is current community perception accurate? Which I think is really what sold this paper and what got it cited a bunch, was that it surprised the community quite a bit, as well as it was an okay example of a coding paper about commits and what large commits were about. Furthermore, not everything that's useful is useful now, and we won't necessarily know if it's useful until later. The stuff that's immediately applicable could go out of fashion and out of date immediately, whereas some of the science aspects and iterative science could actually go on further for a long time and provide use to future tools and things like that. It's far less fashionable. is I really want us to think about, should we have different review guidelines for a software science paper versus an engineering paper? Should we be rejecting stuff because we don't buy the motivation? Should we be rejecting stuff over motivation? Should we only be accepting things that are technically correct versus well-motivated? There's a lot of questions to be had. And I think that's where most of our discussion is going to be, is what do we do about this? And, you know, if we're not counting stuff on motivation, what happens when we have a lot of papers? Are there methods of handling that, as well as what we can do for reviewers to make it easier, more comprehensible, understandable, such that we can do software science? And what do we have to do in our software science papers in order to ensure that they are good enough to be accepted and they're not saying wild things and all that kind of stuff? Anyways, thank you for your time. I had fun making this and digging in the past, and I appreciate the help all of you, that many of you have given, in terms of citing the paper such that this MIP talk is possible. Thank you.